Hello children, welcome back to 8th standard biology class. We were discussing about reproduction in animals and two types of fertilization we were discussing about. We have already discussed, let us once recall what we have discussed in the last class and move on to the next topic. Now we have discussed about the two types of fertilization. You know what is fertilization? It is the process of fusion of male gamete and female gamete, or fusion of sperm with the ovum is called fertilization. It may take place inside the body of a female, then it is called internal fertilization, and it may take place outside the body of the female, then it is called external fertilization. What are the differences between internal and external fertilization? Let us quickly go through once, recall, and let us move on to the next topic and write these in your notebook, children. All the differences and points, whatever we go through here, you must write it in your classwork book or test notebook. It's very important. Write without fail. Yes, internal fertilization, this process takes place inside the female body. External fertilization takes place outside the body of the females. And in internal fertilization, animals produce less number of eggs. So less number of eggs are produced by such females, as there are high chances of survival of the offspring. Chances of survival of the offsprings are more. So less number of eggs are produced by the females in internal fertilization. Since chances of survival of offsprings is less, during external fertilization, organisms produce a large number of eggs. A large number of eggs are produced by females, as the chances of survival of the offspring are very low. And examples for internal fertilization, cow, goat, sheep, cat, dog, all these animals including human beings, and hence our birds undergo internal fertilization. And external fertilization example, aquatic animals like fishes and amphibians like frogs. Fishes and amphibians like frogs and toads undergo external fertilization. And how external fertilization takes place in frogs and toads, that we have learnt already. Let us once go through quickly. The frogs and toads reproduce by laying eggs in slow stream or ponds. So they need water to complete their life cycle, hence they are called amphibians. They live both on the land and in water. The female frogs first lay hundreds of eggs together in the water. These eggs are not covered with any hard shell. Instead of that, there is a jelly-like substance that guards and holds the eggs together. So jelly-like substance holds all the eggs together. As the female frogs lay their eggs, the male frogs deposit the sperms over them. This results in external fertilization, means fertilization takes place in water outside the body of the female. When the sperms come in contact with the eggs in water, fertilization takes place. Though the eggs are large in numbers, only a few of them manage to survive. Even though they produce a large number of eggs, a few of them will survive. What is the reason for this? There are several factors which may hinder the process of fertilization. So, what are the factors that hinder the fertilization process? It is water movement, rainfall, and winds also, and other animals eat the eggs also. So because of all these factors, for most of the eggs will be destroyed. Only a very few of them get fertilized and survive. So they produce a large number of eggs. Now let us move on to internal fertilization in hens, in birds and human beings, cat, dog, cows, here all internal fertilization takes place. Means fertilization takes place inside the body of a female. How in hens internal fertilization takes place? Let us go through quickly. Hens reproduce by laying eggs. After the formation of the zygote, means inside the body of the female only fertilization takes place, fusion of sperm and egg takes place inside the body and zygote is formed. After the formation of zygote, it keeps on dividing itself and traveling through the ovator, travel down through the ovator. In this process, different protective layers are formed around the fertilized egg and then turns into a hard shell. Finally, the hard shell is formed around the egg. That is the final covering of the fertilized egg, so that it covers the egg. What happens? During this process, different protective layers are formed over the egg and then that turns into a hard shell or covering of the egg. When this hard shell is formed, then the hen lays the eggs. Here, fertilization only takes place inside the body. Further development takes place outside the body. So, when the hard shell is formed, the hen lays egg. Then, it takes almost 3 weeks for the embryo to develop into a chick. So, later when the hens lay their eggs, it takes 3 weeks for the further development into a chick. The embryo inside the egg develops into a chick in 3 weeks. So, it takes almost 3 weeks for the embryo to develop into a chick. During this time, you might have observed the hen often sits over the eggs to provide its sufficient warmth is necessary for the hatching of eggs. So, for that purpose, to provide sufficient warmth to the egg for hatching, hen sits over the eggs and gives warmth to the eggs. Now, what are test tube babies? We have also learnt about test tube babies. It means babies are not born in test tubes. Some women have the problems in their oviduct or fallopian tube. Maybe blocked. They may have blocked fallopian tube so that fertilized sperm cannot reach the egg and fertilization cannot take place. In such conditions, doctors conduct IVF, in vitro fertilization. In vitro means outside the body. In the petri dish, in safe aseptic conditions, fertilization will occur. So, such a process is called in vitro fertilization. In vitro means outside the body, in the petri dish fertilization occurs. In vitro fertilization or IVF, what they do, the doctors collect freshly released egg of the mother or females and freshly released sperms of the males and then allowed to fertilize in the petri dish in the laboratory conditions. Under the safe aseptic laboratory conditions, the eggs and sperms are allowed to fertilize. So, fertilization takes place outside the body in the petri dish under safe laboratory conditions. The zygote is formed by the fertilization and which is allowed to develop for a week outside the female body in safe conditions, and then it is placed in the woman's uterus. So, after fertilization, zygote is allowed to develop for a week outside the female body in a safe conditions, and it is then placed in the uterus of the mother or the female. Uterus of the female or the mother, so that the further development of the embryo takes place inside the uterus of the mother. Later, the babies that, so in this way, these women can bear babies. Then, normally how the females give birth to young ones, the same way they can give birth to the young one. So, this process, since the babies that are born with the IVF process are called test tube babies. By the contraction of the uterus, after the complete development of the fetus, the baby will born by the contraction of the muscles of the uterus. Why such babies are called test tube babies? Since these babies are born with IVF process, means in vitro fertilization, means fertilization is conducted outside the body in the petri dish by collecting the egg from the female and sperms from the males under aseptic laboratory conditions, means safe conditions. Fertilization is conducted outside the body. Since babies are born by IVF process, they are called test tube babies. And we have also discussed about the development of embryo in human beings. A female produces every month a matured egg. Every month females produce, means which part of the female reproductive system produces eggs? Ovary. In females, one of the ovaries produces a matured egg every month. If that egg gets, this process of release of matured egg from the ovary is called ovulation process. Process of release of matured egg from the ovary is called ovulation. And suppose if that egg is fertilized by the sperm, the zygote is formed and the zygote starts dividing continuously to form a ball of cells called embryo. And these cells of the embryo group into different groups, and then that embryo embeds itself into the wall of the uterus. So when the embryo embeds itself in the wall of the uterus, this process is called implantation. Then the further development of the embryo takes place inside the uterus of the female. So let us quickly glance over the development of embryo. The zygote formed after fertilization process divides itself in a repeated manner and forms a ball of cells. These cells then form different groups, and each group then starts developing into different tissues and organs. That different groups of cells formed, they start developing into different tissues and organs. Then this structure is called an embryo, and the embryo embeds itself into the uterus wall, and the process is called implantation, and then it continues to develop and grow. And gradually all the individual parts such as hands, legs, feet, eyes, ears start developing. This stage of the embryo, whose parts can be identified individually, is called the fetus. So when the embryo develops individual parts and clearly that can be identified, that stage of embryo is called fetus. Fetus completely develops inside the uterus of the mother and takes birth as baby. As I said, by the contraction of the muscles of the uterus, baby will born. So this is how development takes place in the human beings. Now, what is the difference between zygote and fetus? Fetus is the stage of embryo where all the individual parts are well defined. So here embryo written fetus. You have to make a correction here. The differences between zygote and fetus. F-O-E-T-U-S. Make a correction here. Fetus is also the stage of embryo where all the individual parts are identified or well defined. So write there fetus. Now what differences are there between zygote and fetus? A zygote consists of a single cell. Zygote is a single cell, but embryo consists of more than one cell. Fetus has many cells, and zygote is formed by the fertilization process, by the fusion of sperm and the ovum. Zygote will be formed, means the process of fertilization results in the formation of a zygote. And fetus is formed, embryo is formed after the fertilization process, and the zygote starts dividing continuously and forms the stage called embryo. And embryo develops all the organs, individual parts, and then it is called fetus. So fetus is formed after the fertilization process, and zygote has no well-defined organs or tissues. So zygote has no well-defined organs or tissues, but in the fetus, the parts and tissues are well-defined in the fetus. So in the fetus, all the tissues and organs are well-defined, can be clearly identified. And let us see what are viviparous animals and oviparous animals. Depending upon how the organisms give birth to their offspring, the organisms can be classified into, or the animals can be classified into, viviparous and oviparous animals. Viviparous means these are the animals which give birth to their young ones directly. For example, cat, cow, goat, human beings, they do not lay eggs. They directly give birth to young ones. Such animals which give birth to their young ones directly are called viviparous animals. So that are animals such as fishes, frogs, amphibians, reptiles and birds. What, how they reproduce? They reproduce by laying eggs. So the animals which reproduce by laying eggs are called oviparous animals. Ova means eggs. So animals that lay eggs and reproduce are called oviparous animals. For example, fishes, reptiles, amphibians, even birds are oviparous animals. So these are the two categories of animals depending upon how they produce their young ones or offspring. Now let us move on to another topic. You might have observed a cat gives birth to a kitten that resembles its parents. Whatever individual parts the mother cat has, the same parts the kitten also consists of. Only the difference is in the size and weight. Means they resemble their, directly resemble their parents. But in some organisms like butterflies, insects like butterflies, silk moth, and amphibians like frogs, the young ones hatched out of the eggs do not directly resemble the adults. Look at here, the adult frog lays eggs and the young ones hatched out of the eggs, which are called tadpoles. The young ones of the frogs are called tadpoles. They do not resemble directly the adult. They are looking like, see, the fish. Looking like fish, after undergoing many changes, they start resembling their parent. So after undergoing drastic changes, they turn into adults. So, but in some animals like insects, butterflies, silk moth, etc., and in some animals like amphibians, frogs and toads, this type of development we observe. Means young ones hatched out of the eggs do not resemble their adult directly. After undergoing many changes, they turn into adults. Such a development is called indirect development, and this tadpole is the larval form. Egg, larval form and the adult. So the three important stages are there in the life cycle of frog. Frog lays eggs. So eggs, larval forms are called tadpoles. Larvae and the froglet, small frog, and then it turns into adult. So egg, larva and adult are the three stages of the development of frog, or life cycle of frog. So as individuals are born, they continue to grow until they turn into adults. The young ones may or may not look like the same when they become adults. So when they are born, they look like same as their adults. That development, such as animals, cats, cows, goat, sheep, human beings here, the young ones produced, they are same like their parents. So that is direct development. But in frogs and insects like butterflies and silk moths, the young ones do not resemble their adult, but there are a lot of difference between the young ones and the adult. After undergoing many changes, they look like adults. That is indirect development. So, for instance, in the case of frogs, and silk moth. Silk moth, the adults and young ones are completely different. After undergoing many changes, they turn into adults. So what is metamorphosis? This process of transformation of a larval form into an adult after undergoing drastic changes is called metamorphosis. So what is metamorphosis? It is a process of transformation of larval form into an adult after undergoing many changes or many drastic changes take place, and the larva gets transformed into adult. So this process of transformation of a larva into an adult after many changes is called metamorphosis. The process in which the young ones undergo drastic changes as they develop into an adult is called metamorphosis. Human beings do not undergo metamorphosis. Such development is called direct development. This is because their body parts remain the same from the childhood to adulthood. So in the young baby also the same body parts, and in the adults also the same body parts. So they do not undergo metamorphosis. So this is the life history of silk moth. Adult silk moth produces eggs. Eggs hatch into young ones called larval form. Larvae. Larval forms of silk moth are called caterpillar or silk worms. You have learnt it. 7th standard. Silk worms are caterpillar. The next stage is pupa, and around the pupa cocoons develop, and it changes into pupa, changes into an adult silk moth after undergoing many changes. So it has the stages: egg, larva, pupa and the adult. So these are the stages in the life cycle of silk moth. Now, let us move on to another topic, asexual reproduction. You have learnt in your previous class in 7th standard about asexual reproduction. Asexual, here only one parent is involved and produces the young ones. Means here there is no formation of male and female gametes and no fusion of male and female gametes. So the process of reproduction in which single parent is involved, only one parent is involved, is called asexual reproduction. And you have also learnt that the young ones produced in asexual reproduction exactly resemble their parents, since only one parent is involved and there is no fusion of male and female gametes. The young ones produced exactly resemble their parents. Such a reproduction is called asexual reproduction. And you have learnt some methods of asexual reproduction in 7th standard, such as budding in yeast. A bulge or a bud-like outgrowth develops on the parent organism, and it develops, grows in size and becomes matured and detaches from the parent cell and becomes a new individual. Budding in yeast you have learnt. And you have also learnt about the process of fragmentation also. In Spirogyra, the body splits into many fragments or pieces, and each piece develops into new Spirogyra. Spirogyra is a green algae which undergo fragmentation, means the filament breaks into smaller and smaller fragments or pieces, and each fragment develops into new individual. That is fragmentation. And you have also learnt about vegetative reproduction or vegetative propagation in higher plants. We cut the stem part and grow it into new plant, or the root part in radish, beetroot etc. is used to grow new plants. So such a reproduction in higher plants is called vegetative propagation. Parts of the plant like root, stem and leaves are used to produce new plants. That you have learnt in 7th standard. Now let us learn about budding in a lower multicellular organism called hydra. Look at the structure of a hydra. It is a lower multicellular animal. And here, can you observe a small bulge is developing from the parent hydra. So this is the parent hydra. A small bulge which is called the bud develops on the parent body. It grows in size and develops the parts, and when it completely matures, it detaches from the parent body and develops into new hydra or new individual. Not only one bud, the parent may develop many buds on its body and all grow in size, and when it becomes matured, it detaches from the parent and develops into new individual. Such a method is called budding. So this type of reproduction involves only one parent. Which one? Asexual reproduction involves only one parent. In amoeba, microscopic animals like amoeba also, and in small lower animals like hydra also. Budding in hydra, just like yeast, reproduction in hydra takes place through the process of budding. The hydra possesses different bulges on itself called buds. The bulges produced on the parent hydra are called buds. These buds develop into individual hydra. So one parent may develop many buds, and all the buds develop into new individuals. So each hydra can possess a different number of buds, and these buds develop into new individuals. The method is called budding. And another method of asexual reproduction, which is observed in unicellular organism amoeba, which is called fission. What is the meaning of the term fission? Fission means division. The body divides into two, and first the nucleus divides into two, and then the body divides into two. Each part gets a nucleus, so that one amoeba produces two amoebae by simple division. So this is called binary fission. Bi means two. One individual divides into two. Such a asexual reproduction in which single individual divides into two daughter individuals is called binary fission. So amoeba consists of only one cell. Look at the structure of amoeba, single celled organism. What happens when the asexual reproduction binary fission takes place? Its single nucleus first divides into two. Observe here, the nucleus first divides into two, which is followed by the division of the amoeba into two, so that the body of amoeba also divides into two, so that the single cell divides into two, and each part gets one nucleus and develop into new amoeba. So how many daughter amoebae are formed? From one single amoeba, two daughter amoebae are formed. So this, as it reproduces, that what happens? The nucleus of amoeba divides itself and forms two different nuclei, and then the division of the body takes place, and amoeba body of the amoeba divides into two, and each part receives one nucleus, and two amoebae are formed. Two amoebae are produced from a single parent. This is nothing but simple cell division. Means amoeba is unicellular. The single cell divides into two. First the nucleus divides, and then the body or amoeba cell divides into two. This is called binary fission. Now in the last topic, let us learn how a clone is formed. A mammal clone, Dolly, is produced by cloning. How? What is cloning? Cloning is nothing but production of an exact copy of a cell or any other living part or the entire organism is called cloning. So what is cloning? Cloning is a technique of producing a living cell or other living part or entire living organism is called cloning. Cloning of an animal was successfully performed in sheep by Ion Wilmot and his colleagues at the Roslin Institute in Edinburgh, Scotland. They successfully cloned a sheep named Dolly. Observe here, Dolly was born on 5th July 1996, which was the first mammal clone developed by Ion Wilmot and his colleagues. Look at here, fin dorset sheep and Scottish black face ibb, and from, by taking these, Dolly, the clone was produced. How they produced the clone? Here they collected the mammary gland cell from fin dorset sheep and egg cell from Scottish black face ibb, and nucleus is present in the cell collected from fin dorset sheep and from the egg collected from Scottish black face ibb, nucleus was removed, and then it is the egg was obtained from a Scottish black face ibb. The nucleus was removed from the egg from the black face ibb, Scottish black face ibb, egg collected, from that nucleus is removed. Then the nucleus of mammary gland cell collected from fin dorset sheep was inserted into the egg of Scottish black face ibb, whose nucleus has been removed. Then the egg thus produced was implanted into the Scottish black face ibb. Then the further development of the egg took place normally in the which female Scottish black face ibb, and finally Dolly was born. But though Dolly was given birth by Scottish black face ibb, which did not show any character of Scottish black face ibb, which showed all the characters of fin dorset sheep. Thus successfully fin dorset sheep clone of fin dorset sheep from which the nucleus was taken, that showed the characteristics of fin dorset sheep only. So that a clone of fin dorset sheep was produced by Ion Wilmot successfully. Since the nucleus from the egg of the Scottish black face ibb was removed, Dolly did not show any character of Scottish black face ibb. Dolly was a healthy clone of fin dorset sheep. Since the nucleus of mammary gland cell of this fin dorset sheep is retained, it showed the characteristics of fin dorset sheep and produced several offspring of her own through normal sexual means. Unfortunately, Dolly died in the year 2003 on 14th February due to certain lung disease. After that, no mammal clone was produced. Let us learn in the next class. See you then.